worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. Healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are here,
turning lives around.
I worship you.
I worship you.
You are here, mending every heart. Worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. 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 You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Good morning. Good to be seated if you would. Arnie's going to be passing out the communion. Make sure that you open the bread first. You'll have a little trouble otherwise. I want you to think with me this morning about why Jesus came. You know, people sometimes ask, well, what's the good news? Well, the good news is that God left heaven and came to earth, showed us what God is like. He showed us how to live our lives. He provided for our salvation, and he provided for our eternal life, and he overcame the powers of darkness, the power of Satan. So we have a lot to be grateful for as we receive the bread and the cup this morning. I'd like to read these words that were spoken by Jesus. When the hour came, Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." So, Lord, this morning, as we receive this body, which is a symbol of your, this bread, which is a symbol of your body, and this cup, which is a symbol of your blood, we're so grateful, Lord, for your goodness to us. You showed us what God is really like, that he's a God of love, a God who helps people and ministers to people, a God who gave his life for people. And Lord, you overcame the power of darkness in our life if we'll just receive it and walk in it. And Lord, you gave us eternal life. We're so thankful for that. I was so thankful the other day, Lord, when I was talking about my friend Ron, that I got to say, this is not the end of Ron. We have life eternal because you made provision for it, and we're so thankful for that. So we receive this bread and this cup in the name of Jesus and all the benefits of the cross in Jesus' name. Let's partake together. Thank you, Lord.
Every time I tried to make it on my own, every time I tried to stand and start to fall, and on those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, there was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, couldn't see, yeah, there was Jesus. For this man who needs amazing kind of grace, forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know, couldn't see, there was Jesus on the mountain, in the valleys. There was Jesus in the shadows of the alleys. There was Jesus in the fire, in the flood. There was Jesus always in and always was. In the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Oh, every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it, there was Jesus. There hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone.
Gentlemen, isn't he good? This is a little bit of a new song.
I call, you answer, and you came to my rescue, and I want to be where you are. I call, you answer, and you came to my rescue, and I want to be where you are.
Sing this with us.
I call. You answer, and you came to come.
You answered,
and you came to my rescue. You are my life, they lifted high in our world, be lifted high in our love, be lifted.
And offerings in just a minute. But before we do that, we want to invite anyone who has a need that you'd like to be prayed for this morning. If you just stand where you are, and people around you will extend their hands toward you and pray with me in just a moment for you. So if you see somebody standing close to you, just extend your hand their way and let's pray for them this morning. Lord, thank you for your grace, for your goodness. I'm so thankful, Lord, that you know every person that's standing this morning. You know exactly what's going on in their life. And Lord, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would be released to bless, to heal, heal relationships, heal bodies, heal financial troubles and woes. Whatever's going on, Lord, that you would move and invade right in the midst of that, Lord, and bring health and blessing. Pray for every person in this room, Lord, that you'd keep us safe, that you'd keep us healthy in the midst of this time. And Lord, we also hold our election up before you. We know that we have a say in it, but we know that ultimately you establish kings and you remove kings. And so we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you for your goodness to us. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen. We're going to receive our tithes and offerings now.
My mind to Calvary, Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. Body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. the entrance seen by heavy stone. Messiah stand and all alone.
Will you stand this morning, please?
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord our God. He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh Lord our God. Oh Lord our God. Oh Lord our God.
Lord, this morning would You speak the thousands of words that I could never speak? And would You help them to lay on receptive ears and willing hearts to respond appropriately? We love You and give You thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. If you brought your Bible, or if you'd like to turn an iPad or iPhone or something to 1 Samuel chapter 1, please. 1 Samuel chapter 1. So, have you ever been... Maybe I should say we all have been in places where it seemed like the wrong side is winning. Maybe in a relationship, maybe in a dispute, maybe in an election, whatever it would be, that we feel like we're doing the right thing as best we can, but it just doesn't seem to be going our way. And we pray, and it doesn't seem like God is answering. I remember on one particular situation that I literally prayed for months. I would walk around the worship center praying day after day after day after day. I think, is this ever going to end? It just didn't seem like it ever would be resolved. We're going to talk about Hannah today. She's the first one that we've talked about. Remember, we're going through, started with Adam and Eve, and then we went to Abraham, and then Joseph. Skip Noah back there someplace. Then Abraham, then Joseph, and then Moses. And now today we're talking about Samuel and Hannah, both kind of at the same time. I chose to speak about Hannah rather than Samuel because of this particular text of Scripture, and she's one of my favorites in the Bible. So I'm going to read beginning in 1 Samuel 1, verse 1. There was a certain man from Ramathaim, a Zuphite from the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, son of Jeroham, and son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. Those are not real familiar names to us, are they? He had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none, which was really a bad thing in that day. Year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and sacrifice to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh, where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of Eli, were priests of the Lord. Wicked priests, by the way. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he loved her and the Lord had closed her womb, or she was barren, as said other places. And because of this, the Lord closed her womb and her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. So there's this conflict taking place year after year after year. Doesn't seem the right thing is going on. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Elkanah, her husband, would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downcast? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons?" So I want you to remember that phrase. So fill in the blanks there, if you would, please. The first one is, we all face the pressures of life. Hannah is such a great example to us because success to a woman, as crazy as this sounds today, success to a woman in that day was to have lots of kids. The more kids you had, the more successful you were. And particularly if you could have boys. That was the real mark of success. So people prayed for boys. Well, Hannah was barren. You just think of that word, barren, unfruitful, desert. You know, it's just not a positive word at all, without life. And she was living in humiliation as a result of that. And so every year when Elkanah would take Peninnah and all of her kids and Hannah up to the house of the Lord at Shiloh, Hannah was inconsolable because of the blessing that would come to all of the children of Peninnah. But she got a double portion because Elkanah loved her. And I love this statement where it says, "Aren't I better to you than 10 sons?" And I could just hear her saying, "Are you kidding me? I want some kids." So it's a picture of disappointment. And when you're disappointed, you feel like a loser, then you're looked down upon, you're not successful. And so what do you do if you feel like you're being mistreated? As a man, I can say, and I think as a woman, you'd probably say it too, you want to stand up and fight. You want to fight back. So the story that always comes to my mind, you may remember me telling this a while back, I went to Oregon Technical Institute for a couple of terms, and probably 10 students from my high school went there, and several of us were in the same dorm. A couple of them were rooming together, and I was right down the hallway, and one of them, his name was Tony, and Tony was two-timing his girlfriend. She was a beautiful girl, and they went together for, I guess, a couple of years in high school, and everybody kind of assumed that they would get married, and ultimately they did. But he was cheating on her. So we're 150 miles away in Klamath Falls, Oregon, and we're from Madras, Oregon. And he'd go home on the weekends and be with Carol, but he'd go during the week and he'd be with this other girl. I have no idea what her name was, but I always saw him driving around with her, and it really hacked me off because I really liked Carol and he'd wanted to be committed to her. So one day, I don't remember what triggered it, but I walked in his room and I walked over to his desk and I said, "Stand up and fight like a man." I said, "You two-timer." And you know, he wouldn't stand up, so I just busted him a couple of times right where he was sitting. Stand up like a man. Fight. That's the way we view fighting. Stand up like a man. Stand up like a woman. Notice the phrase, when you can't stand up and fight, kneel down and pray. We think asserting ourselves is the most powerful thing that we can do, but the most powerful thing we can do is to get on our knees and pray. In Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews talks about coming before the throne of grace that we might find grace or help in our time of need. When we get on our knees, then heaven can be poured out upon us and we can gain God's strength. Kneeling is regarded as a position of weakness by many. You know, if somebody would say, "Oh, you kneel down," you know, it's the implication of you kneel down and beg. Well, it's not kneeling down and begging with God. It's a kneeling down and submitting your life to His will and His purpose and asking heaven to be unleashed on our lives. So powerful thing is prayer. I get so mad when people say, "Well, all we can do is pray." Like, well, it's all over, but I guess we can pray about it. Well, that's the worst possible way to look at prayer. Notice these words of Jesus. "In this world, you will have trouble." It's a promise. Probably not one you memorized. "You will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." So he's saying, you're going to have trouble, and when you do, turn to the Lord, because He has overcome the world. It's kind of a double promise there. So not only are we to face our pressures, but secondly, we must look at prayer this way. Prayer is powerful. It's a powerful, powerful thing. "Once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest was sitting on a chair by the doorpost of the Lord's temple. In bitterness of soul," it doesn't mean she's bitter, it means that her soul is in turmoil, in anguish. "Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord. And she made a vow saying, 'O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me,'" notice those words, "'remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head.'" So picture, Hannah comes and she kneels down and her lips are moving, but there's no noise coming out of her mouth. She's praying silently. Well, Eli thinks she's drunk. But she talked to him, she reasoned with him, and he ended up blessing her. But I want you to hear the words in her prayer, "Remember me." Say that with me. Remember me. So think of a situation in your life right now where you're facing adversity in some way in your life. And just let those words go before the Lord. "Would you remember me in that situation?" Now, when you think of "remember me," you have all kinds of ways of thinking about that. You might think, "Remember me, Lord, you see me, remember me." Or you might think the old-fashioned way of remembering things was you'd tie a string around your finger so you wouldn't forget something. And then there's the old-fashioned palm pilot. You know, when you take a pen and write in the palm of your hands, you ever do that? That's the original palm pilot. So it's there so that you'll remember something that you're supposed to remember. Well, some of you remember Josh Stewart that used to work here. And Josh was always late every place he went. And some people would say to me, "Well, that's a cultural thing. You're not going to get him over that." I thought, no, it's not. He needs to learn to be on time. So I talked to him. Nothing seemed to be working. So finally, I saw him with his cell phone one day, and he's always on his cell phone. So I said, "Josh," I said, "you love that cell phone, don't you?" "Yeah." "Everything, your whole life is on that cell phone, right?" "Yeah." "I want you to do something. I want you to go through, and every appointment that you have, I want you to set an alarm for that appointment. maybe 15 minutes ahead of time, or if you have to drive to get there, however long it'll take you to drive, plus 10 minutes, so you can be early. So I want you to set an alarm every time you have an appointment, okay? Okay. So he did, and he was always on time after that. Simple little thing, but he did something to jog his memory. And what we're saying is, Lord, I know you're aware of everything, but please remember me. Remember me. I remember praying that so many times in one situation. I'd say, Lord, I want that other person to do well, but remember me. My heart is for you. Then it goes on to say, Eli answered, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. And she said, may your servant find favor in your eyes. Then she went her way and ate something. And notice these words, and her face was no longer downcast. In other words, normally when we pray, we'll pray, but then we walk away with it. Says she, remember me, and it says her face was no longer downcast. Why? Because she left it there. Now, you've heard me talk about my dog, Jake. And Jake kind of lives for food. And the other day, I ate a bag of popcorn every night. So I took the empty bag that was still warm, and I wrinkled it up. I put it over by my chair. And Jake comes around, and he moves toward that bag, and he kind of sniffs it. And I said, leave it. And you could just see it on his face. He doesn't want to. He wants that popcorn bag so bad. And so if he thinks I'm not looking, he'll start moving toward it again. Leave it. So I want to say to you with your prayers, when you bring something before the Lord, leave it there. Leave it there. Let the Lord carry that. Let the Lord be in charge of that. And let your face no longer be downcast, as it says about Hannah. Then it goes on to say, early in the morning they arose and worshipped before the Lord, and then went back to their home at Ramah. Elkanah lay with his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. Love that. The Lord remembered her. So in the course of time, Hannah conceived and gave birth to a son, and she named him Samuel, saying, because I asked the Lord for him. The name Samuel means asked of God. So she named him after the Lord answering that promise. So, first of all, I want to say, if you have a son that you want to give to the Lord, don't bring him to me. I don't want him. I'm too old for that. I'm beyond that. Maybe 30 years ago I would have, but not now. So God went to work on her behalf, and she bore a son. And then notice the response, give back to the Lord what he has given to you. So I want you to think about something. We would all say, we believe the Lord can do more than we can do. Well, let's say I've got $100 in my pocket, and I realize that everything that I have has been given to me by the Lord. So if I have $100 in my pocket, and I can think about, well, I can use that for this, the Lord could use it for this, who do you think is going to be the best use for your money? The Lord is. So if you give it to the, if you keep it, and we've all done that, we use our money for certain things and we can accomplish certain things. But think about if we give our money to the Lord, how much more comes from that? If we give our life to the Lord, how much more comes from that than what we would gain on our own? So it's easy to give to the Lord when you believe it belongs to him and that he can do things more effectively than you can. So give back to the Lord what he has given to you. Live with an open hand. I said this morning, started that one way and I didn't, I said another way. When I was growing up, I didn't know it, but we were fairly poor. And I think about what the Lord has done in my life. I've lived a charmed life, someone told me one time. Why? Because my parents and I dedicated my life to the Lord, and he made a lot better, trust me, he did a lot better with my life than I would have on my own. So take great pride in the Lord's goodness and what he can do through you. The story goes on to say, but Samuel was ministering before the Lord, a boy wearing a linen ephod, that's a priestly robe. Each year his mother made him a little robe and took it to him, and when she went up with her husband to offer the annual sacrifice, Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife, saying, "May the Lord give you the children, give you children by this woman to take the place of the one she prayed for and gave to the Lord." Then they would go home, and the Lord was gracious to Hannah. She conceived and gave birth to 3 sons and 2 daughters. Meanwhile, the boy Samuel grew up in the presence of the Lord. So not only did the Lord bless her with Samuel, but the Lord gave her 3 more sons and 2 more daughters that were a blessing to her. So think, just kind of imagine that, Ma, as you think about you gave your son to the Lord, and every year, you haven't seen him for a year, you go back and you see him, you think, "Oh gosh, look what the Lord is doing in your life." And she took this little robe that she made, she'd give it to him, "Look what the Lord is doing in your life." She was so proud of him. And when you look at your kids, you think, "Oh my, you're so proud of them." And that was true of her as well. Now, I've said this before, and I'm going to say it again intentionally. I probably won't say it as long as I'm here again. But my parents loved my older brother, Larry. He was smart, went to college, he was an athlete. And my dad was just proud as punch of my brother, Larry. And my middle brother, Marlon, had personality plus. His personality, his temperament, and his behavior is much like my dad's. So he and my dad got along really, really well. They loved Marlon. And I knew it, but I wasn't really aware of it until my mom one day when I was in my 40s described them that way. She said, "We love Larry, we love Marlon." And then there was Stan. Oh. And when she said that, it was like, "Oh my goodness, that explains a lot of things." Now, I tell it now, and I'm not wounded by that. I've gotten over that a long, long time ago. But I like to tell that story simply because of this. Because my mom, this little Baptist lady, came to live with us when I was, I think I was in my late 30s when she came to live with us. And she saw the church growing, and when she came, we were probably 600 people or so, and the church was growing and flourishing and everything. And I know my mama sat there and said, "Only God could do that." But isn't that great? Only God could do that. And trust me, I know that more than anybody. So the boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was laying down in his usual place, and the lamp of the Lord had not yet gone out. And Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. "Samuel," he answered, "here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, "I didn't call you, go back and lie down." So he went back and laid down. Now that happened 3 times. So the third time, finally, when he came in and said, "You called me," he says, "No, I didn't call you." And Eli realized that's the voice of the Lord. He had never heard the voice of the Lord, but now he has. He said, "You go back and lay down, and when he calls again, you say, 'Here I am, Lord.'" Because that's God talking to you. As a result of that, of course, Samuel is one of the most, he got two books in the Bible named after him, which is not too bad. And he was a remarkable, remarkable man in his time. Now, one of the significant things about Samuel was that he was between the judges and the kings. He was the transition point between those two. So he was a judge, but then he laid hands on both Saul and David. So he was that transition. And this was a wicked time. In fact, when the people would bring their sacrifices to the temple, Eli's sons would make the women have sex with them before they'd receive their sacrifice. It's a horribly, horribly wicked time, and destitute spiritually, lots of corruption. So Samuel and Hannah are bright spots, definitely bright spots, in this very difficult period of history, which had been going on all through the book of Judges over and over and over again, since they did what was right in their own eyes, and then God's judgment came against them over and over and over again. So Samuel kind of broke that cycle and was a wonderful, wonderful man of God. So I want you to bow your heads, and I want you to think about Hannah, who was a bright spot, and Samuel, who was a bright spot in this season of time. And I want you to think about a point of pressure in your life right now. Everybody in the room's got some point of pressure in their life. Think about a point of pressure, and I just want to say to you, you know what? That's normal. We think, well, God's mad at us, or we did something wrong, we sinned, we're dumb, we made some mistake. No, trouble is normal in life. All of us have trouble. Sometimes it's our mistake, sometimes it's somebody else's mistake, sometimes it's just stupidity, make bad decisions. So trouble is normal. It's a normal part of our life. But what do we do in the midst of that trouble? That's the question. So the lesson of the day is, when you're in trouble, pray. Kneel down and fight. Let the Lord fight for you and leave it there. Don't pick it up and walk away. Leave it there. Maybe that point you're struggling with right now, you just need to leave it here this morning. Let God take care of that. You can't do anything about it. Let Him take care of it. And then thirdly, just look around your life and brag on all that God has done. Every one of us have so many things to be thankful for. Do we have stress? Of course we do. But we also have lots of things that we can be grateful for and thank the Lord for. So this morning, I wonder if there's someone here today who has never turned your life over to the Lord. You've never invited Jesus Christ to be the Lord of your life and ask Him for forgiveness for a life of sin that you've lived. If you haven't done that, I'd like to ask you this morning, while every head is bowed, every eye is closed, if you want to acknowledge the Lordship of Jesus in your life, you want to be your boss from now on and follow Him and serve Him and receive forgiveness, would you just lift up your head and lift up your hand, and your hand would be saying, Pastor, today I give my life to the Lord. Yes, I see you. And may God grant you great peace and great forgiveness. May you walk away knowing you've done that and it's sealed now. It's sealed. You don't need to do that anymore. But day by day, ask the Lord to help you to serve Him and live for Him. Amen. So Lord, we love you today and we give you thanks for your goodness and your grace. Help us not to carry the weight of our troubles, but to leave them here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Will you stand with us and we'll finish with a quick song here, please.
I walked in the sunlight where your blessings abound. I've been through the dark night where troubles are found. On the heights of rejoicing from the depths of my pain, let the song that I'm singing remain the same. Praise you, praise you, Son of God, Son of Man. Song that will never end. Blessing and honor and glory and power. Blessing and honor and glory and power. Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto our God. Join the song that will never end. I've joined the song that will never end.
All right, go out and enjoy a wonderful, beautiful day. There aren't going to be too many more like this, so go ahead and enjoy this day. God bless you. See you later.